So we don't question.
Hello, we got here at last. My name is Bruce Green, and for my sins, I'm a formulation chemist. So over the years, I've specialised really in skincare and hair care products, but I've also specialised in formulation chemistry for needs. So it goes way back, a little bit of history. My grandfather had a company in Northampton, where I come from, which was named Boot and Shoe. And he was in charge of providing the dyes and pigments to the leather trade for doing fixing, and also to the local newspaper with the pigments for that too. And also, I think he was using it as an excuse to not get called up in the First or Second World War, but he survived doing that. My father followed on from that and continued working with ICI and using pigments again, mainly for the leather trade. He was a lecturer at the Leather Sellers College for many, many years. So chemistry sort of goes right in my background. And my father had a small unit for packaging the dyes right in the center of Northampton. And it was called in the street, Scarlet Well Street. And I didn't understand until I was young that that's why it was scarlet, because all the packaging of the dyes turned the wells scarlet. Minor thing. People in Northampton don't understand where that name came from. So after uni, I worked. My first major job was Avon Cosmetics, whereas in Northampton at that time, they employed around 5,000 people, and it was the largest cosmetic factory in Europe. And Avon on its own, if you took the other three top brands and added them together, they were still about the 10th of Avon Cosmetics. How times changed. My first job with them was looking at the formulations of Avon in America and making them suitable for Europe. And it was a very simple job. All you did was tone down the fragrances. They would put 1% in, we went down to 0.1%. for the European marketplace. So things changed a lot from that. Avon were very good to me. They took me to America and to New York to do formulation work for them there. And I stayed for many, many years. And also, besides the brands of cosmetic products, I started to look at niche markets. And I was based in Minneapolis, and there were quite a few problems in Minneapolis at that time of children being upset by the surface and contamination on fruit and vegetables. And a lot of children were put into hospital because of preservative level. Looking at these things, I decided what I ought to do is look at niche markets for doing formulation works, and developed at that time some products for washing fresh fruit and vegetables under the brand Veggie Wash, which was taken over by Colgate and is still manufactured and sold all over the world. So I like the idea of niche marketplaces. So coming back to UK, and you look at needs, and we were going into lockdown at that time. And what was happening, people were not going out to hairdressers, etc., but women and men still wanted to color their hair. Say they'll go to Boots, buy a color wash to put onto their hair, never read the instruction because none of us ever do. You end up perhaps with orange hair or funny colored hair that doesn't work. So what do? You either shaved your head off and waited for it to grow out, or what you do is buy a product called CB4, which was colored before, which is reducing chemistry, used in the leather trade many years ago. You put it on your hair, you reduced it, and it turned you back to the color you were before. Old chemistry, new marketplace. The first year of CB4, we sold 5 million units. Hard to believe, but that was a product of the time and a requirement of the time. And again, we come back to niche markets. And one of the best niche markets for me was really working with Olympus in Japan. I had some good contacts who worked in their laboratories there. And living in Northampton, in the hospital at Kettering, was the first medical staff to sue the hospital management board for upsetting and causing them big problems with their skin because they were using glutaraldehyde for disinfecting medical instruments. And in those days, they also had large reprocessing plants for putting the endoscopes in before use between patients. They had to be sterile, so they had to, whatever you're using had to be sporicidal. So glutaraldehyde was used for many years. Johnson & Johnson, Sidex was the name of the product. It was the benchmark for probably 20 years in the industry. And again, looking at it and thinking, there had to be a better way. This was local, reading the local newspapers, the hospital staff. So you looked at oxidation chemistry, and I looked at chlorine dioxide. You know, it's a nice product, very volatile. You have to produce it in situ and it disappears, but it's very effective material. So I looked at the possibility of using of chlorine dioxide and using sodium chloride in simplification. Biggest problem was you made it and it took, you acidified it. It didn't matter what, we used citric acid, it didn't really matter what the acidification was. But it took quite a long time to generate the chlorine dioxide. And it was always at a very acidic pH. Corrosion is a main issue in endoscopes. The average endoscope costs between 50,000 and 200,000. They're expensive pieces of kit. And the faster they can turn around between patients, the better. But glutaraldehyde took 8 hours for the work that we did on chlorine dioxide. I had a lucky stroke, bang in bed, think, let's try this around, modified the balance on the pH, and was able to generate from sodium chloride solution chlorine dioxide with a neutral pH in probably 15 seconds instead of maybe taking an hour. Worked on the material, it was sporicidal, a big difference. 8 hours Sidex, 8 minutes with our system on chlorine dioxide. The world, particularly Olympus, beat a path to our door to license that chemistry. It revolutionized endoscope reprocessing. Instead of having to wait overnight for several days before you could take it to another patient, you could disinfect and sterilize it within minutes to move it straight on. So they had a big turnaround. And that was probably one of our biggest things. I think that's what kind of gave me a fellowship because of the work we did in that area at the RSC. So what I'm saying to you, formulation chemistry, one, it's fascinating. And it's fascinating because you look for niche markets. And that's what I enjoy doing. Developing something for a need, patenting if you can, hoping you can sell that idea to somebody else. But it gives you great flexibility. And over the years, it's been very good to me. And I've enjoyed what I do, working with lots and lots of different companies, but keeping an open mind. So chemistry, from my point of view, has been a fantastic career. And I now work with the RSC a lot, and we're on a consultancy committee group. And the main thing that's happened with a lot of the big pharmaceutical companies that made people really good chemists redundant because they haven't got the requirement for them. And what is a semi-retired 50-60-year-old chemist who hasn't got another place to go to? Start on their own as a consultant. So we offer expertise in starting a consultancy, intellectual property work, accountancy work, taxation work, etc. And we now have around 6,000 members through the RSC who work with us on our consultancy committee. So what I'm saying is to you, have an open mind in chemistry, try things and look for niche markets. In my attitude, maybe the right attitude, don't invent something unless you think there's a good need for it. That's always been, look for a problem, try and sort it out. And it's been very good to me. So following on for that, now we're gonna get on the fun stuff because this might sound a little bit strange, but all of a sudden we've moved on. Now we're just gonna get one of these buttons. Okay, I think that one moves us on. It does. Okay, so
I used to work and play polo in Singapore. That's where I've been learned. After one of multiple marriages, I moved to Singapore to get away from exes, but that's a long story. And we won't go. But Singapore was, I loved, and I worked for the Straits Times newspaper for quite a long time there. And when I was there, I learned to play polo, and then came back to England and played at Guards Club here. This is when we ran a team. You can see our team colours, burgundy and green. And we were on a pro-am celebrity team group as well. There's Stuart Copeland for the police in the picture at the bottom. He was on our team. So it was very good. So we were sitting at the Guards Polo Club on Sunday talking about reviving old sports. And somebody said, you know, they used to play polo on elephants. And we all said, what a good idea. But where on earth would we get elephants from? So here's the slight backstory. I was born in Northampton, Colwyn Road. This is the area that I live. Colwyn Road backed onto what was a racecourse in Northampton that hasn't been a racecourse for many years. I'm not sure that's the racecourse or whether it's Ascot, but in my mind, it was the same sort of thing. So this was behind our house. And what then happened on the racecourse, well, following on, my sister, Janet, she's 3 years older than me, and the 3 years gap between siblings is known to be a problem area. It was her birthday. She doesn't look anything like the Adams family girl, does she? No. She had a new bike, very smart new bike. I had a bike. It was pretty old. I was very unhappy about that bike. So what happened? I decided to walk out of the racecourse and go and see Robert Fawcett's circus, which used to winter the animals in Northampton, and also had a big circus tent and a big top. The circus manager, I was there, I just joined them and hid with the animals, and I wouldn't tell them where I lived or be taken home. So they called the police, etc. And he was very nice to the circus manager. He said, Bruce, why don't you join the circus and help during the summer season? Which is what I did. So I looked after a small elephant here, Rani, and this was in 1950s, so you can see the big top there and lots of people. And I really enjoyed it. I worked with them and worked with the clowns at the same time. And the elephants, Rani was my favorite elephant. It was a young elephant then. They lived to about 65, 70 years old. And it was such a handsome elephant. And it was interesting. They had problems with feeding the elephant. And so we trained the elephant to eat when you clapped at the elephant. And so the elephant then got into the unit. And they talk about elephants and whether they remember, and they do, they remember people. They remember if you're unkind to them. They don't, you know, the story of they never forget. They never forget kindness. They never forget cruelty as well. Same thing. And the clowns are very good to me as well. So we had elephants. I lived just outside Northampton. I called Robert Fawcett's circus and said, we need some elephants. Would you bring some over? Because what we want to do is practice for elephant polo. This was all a bit of a joke in our minds. We really didn't think of it. And here we are loading ourselves on the elephants. And this was in my lawn at Northampton, which is still very smooth because the elephants were perfect. So we learned to play, and you can see the elephants. The big problem, these were circus elephants. Okay, so you're learning to play. They're used to walking around in circles and holding each other's tails. Not easy to hit a ball when that happens. The other thing about the sticks, normally on a horse, you play with a between 45 and a 50 inch polo stick, depending on the size of your opponent. And so these sticks have to be combined and made twice the sort of length for that. Also, polo, you can only play with the right hand. You notice that. If you're a left-handed person, it's harder for you to play polo because it can only be played with the right hand. That's a safety rule, that when you pass, you can never have clash with the other person. And the other thing about elephants, who we are practicing again, this is where I put the Robert Fawcett circus in the background. Then what happened was we threw out the gauntlet. One of my jobs I was going out with a good PR girl at the time. And I said, look, we want to do this. We phoned up the local newspaper and Terry Wogan got to hear about the whole thing. And we got world press everywhere. Even to a local beer company, the World Elephant Polo Stout, of course, Singapore. And they sold thousands and thousands of bottles of this. Suddenly, England got behind our polo team, but the whole idea is that we were going to bring back the dumb for Britain. And the same happened with British Airways. They were excellent to us as well. We talked to them, said, no, we'll fly you out. And then the crunch came, where are we going to play? Oh, we had a national send-off from the airport. It looks good, doesn't it? I don't think there are quite that many people there, but it was a good send-off in the end. And we flew to Kathmandu, most dangerous airport in the world. But where were we going to play there?
Mogori airstrip, which is a small grass airstrip. They moved the elephants, jumbos across, out of the way so we could actually play on the grounds there. There's Mogori airstrip, so you can see it was a bit disused. But this is in the Royal Chitwan National Park. Jim Edwards, who was also a polo player I knew, he said, come and play there. We've got about 100 elephants. It's easy. It'll be good for our PR. It'll be good for the holiday areas because they did jungle reserves and lots. And so that was where we started with Mogori. And so we all arrived, and all the world press service arrived. There's some of the elephants going in the morning. We always played there at about 6 o'clock because it got too hot. And it was quite magic because the elephants would line up. You had the Himalayas and Everest in the background and dust. It sort of still brings hairs on the back of my neck because the views early in the morning. That was just wonderful there. And there's some of the elephants playing there too. Yeah. So we turned up and the team. And what do you notice? The elephants were twice the size of the elephants that we practice on. And it was more than a little worrying, I can tell you. There's our team there. So what we all did, you have to realize that these elephants had mahouts for them. Mahouts bought up with the elephants, or the elephants bought up with their mahouts. We had two on each elephant, one at the front and one at the back. And the one at the back was the accelerator, the brake man. The only problem was they only spoke Nepalese. So we're sitting behind the elephants, and you hear, look, we are strapped on to the back of these elephants. This is taking your life in your hands doing this. So you can see we have, these are our stirrups. I've got a little pointer here. Yeah, on the background there, we've strapped ourselves on. And you can see the ropes holding us all on the back of these elephants too. And there's a mahout on the front and a mahout on the back. So the big problem, the mahouts only spoke Nepalese. So we devised a system, and it's worked quite well, a bit like a joystick. So we held the mahout by his clothing at the back of the neck, forwards, backwards, left and right. Fantastic, and it worked really well. And we had a lot of fun playing there. So here we are. They had a big crowd in Kathmandu at the spectators. One of the chaps there, Jim Edwards, also was there. And we had a photographer. This was Don McCullen, who was probably the best photographer in the world at the time. He came over. Harper's and Queen, Cutlass, all the major magazines came over. And we had eight teams came to us as well. So we had an American team, the Nepalese team obviously here, an Indian team, Gurkhas team, Australian team, Scottish team. There were, eight teams, I think, who came over. So we needed a lot of elephants to play. Normal polo, you play a chukka, and you play four or six chukkas, and chukkas 7.5 minutes. Here, we changed it to just two chukkas, 15 minutes each. And there were some issues, because the main thing when we practice in UK, we use normal polo balls, which is here, I've got one, which are polos, pulu, they're willy roots, originally that's where the name came from. And the elephants then, who are quite sharp, like to stamp these into the ground so you couldn't hit them. So we had to change to small inflatable footballs, and that worked quite well. But when we're over there, the ground is rock hard and dusty, so we played with normal polo balls at the time. When the elephants were all lined up and you wanted to choose your elephants in the morning, because the straws were drawn, the smaller elephants, they were more maneuverable. Now, elephants don't run, they walk quickly, keep the same gait, they just move their legs faster. But up to 14 to 15 miles an hour is what they can do, which is quite fast, actually. And also, the other thing with elephants, when they're born, they're ambidextrous, but as they grow up, they choose become left-handed or right-handed elephants. And for me, a player with a right hand, you wanted to play with a right-handed elephant. It's very easy to see. When you see an elephant, look at it. One of the trunks will be smaller on the left side or right side. And that's the bias that they have. So in the mornings, we look for the elephants with the right-handed trunk, which is worn down more, so you could play on that side. Lots of details, isn't it? And the elephant trunk still amazes me. The number of muscles in an elephant's trunk is something like 60,000. And when you think the average human being only has about 500 or 600 muscles in its body anyway. My God, amazing animals, elephants, absolutely amazing. So here we are in full swing with a different team. So you can see that was the Australian team, I think, who came there. Also, the Maharaja of Jaipur came up, and they're three of his princes. They brought their own elephants, can you believe it, from Jaipur up to us in Kathmandu. They're all sitting there looking a little bit surprised. Now, believe it or not, that's me playing number two, scoring the winning goal. But you can see how far you are off the ground there. It was quite a bizarre thing to do. So we had a lot of fun doing it, and it was quite magic. afterwards, lots of celebrations, and the elephants were all decorated very well. Oh, going back a little bit, the three princes here, and it's a size story, or I won't go into it, but those three princes became my three brother-in-laws further down the line. Long, interesting story, but I won't bore you with that at the moment. So, lots of celebrations afterwards, and the decorations and the elephants. So we invited them by the Jaipur group to go down to them in big security and to play in one of their stadiums with the British team versus the Indian team. So we all arrived there, and it was great fun. We thought this would be a good game. It was just one side problem. There's the problem. It was bicycle polo. Their world championship bicycle polo team, we were used to horses or elephants at least. These were fixed wheel bikes. I've still got the scars on my legs from playing here. My legs don't look too bad now, but and so we turned out, we played against their team with all these people. We lost every game we played, but they thought we were good sports. And thank goodness the hospitality carried on. But suddenly turn up expecting we were going to be given horses and you were given a bicycle. It was a bit of a surprise. We came back to England. And it just happened to be Gordon Bennett's birthday. And Gordon Bennett owned the Herald Tribune. And he was also a fanatical polo player. So they contacted me from the States and said, Bruce, will you organize as a celebration for Gordon Bennett's birthday, an elephant polo tournament in England? So we took over Guards Polo Club. Prince Charles was going to play with us. But in the end, because people didn't like the idea of elephant polo, because attitudes were changing and had changed a lot, we had to move to a different polo field, and we played at the Royal Berkshire Cup. So these were the surface elements we worked on, and this is us practicing. Now, somewhere down the line, yeah, how do we start that? Do I just click on it?
I'd have to do it on the...
Can you just show me, just push the right button, that'd be good. This right. Will give you a little background, whichever one it is. If you could start the video, that should start as long as you click it, we hope. Should start. Let's try that. Just try click. Oh, that's on pause.
It's not playing with it, but hopefully.
Yeah, if you can go back to big sound, then should just that's it. Now if you click on the play button there. That one?
It seems to be a picture of the play button, I suppose to
just to go up and push on there somewhere. Just go on. That's it. I think that's all we have to do. Should it though?
No, it's opening on.
No, it's there somewhere. You should just be able to go, I thought, click straight on and then play. We hope.
Let's just be a picture of that. With an icon. Yeah, that's a picture.
Well, talk amongst yourselves, we'll get there. This is an interesting one to see. I understood it was on there, and then went, well, as long as you've got that display, clicked on it and waited a moment, it would come up. Ah.
You have to watch through some.
It was coming up, it was getting close. Can we go back to it? Okay, that's that now. There it goes. Is that it?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So here we are, Royal Berkshire Polo Club.
By virtual monsoon this morning after lumbering onto the Royal County of Berkshire Polo Ground. But if they thought they were in for an easy away day, they were very wrong. And the stars were even more apprehensive. While Rula Lenska tried to make friends with her mount, husband Dennis Waterman was fighting a losing battle trying to get to the ball.
Well, I'm quite a daredevil, and I've done a lot of strange and potentially dangerous things, but that was quite...
It was very rock and roll, which I usually like. Actually, we simply said you actually get seasick before you get stiff.
The match was to mark the 100-year anniversary of the first pony polo match between America and Britain. This is a branch of polo normally only played in the Himalayas. The rules are similar to the pony version, though the sticks are longer, the chuckers thankfully shorter, and the mounts aren't allowed to reverse. They try telling the elephants that. But the game met with opposition from the RSPCA. They claim not only is it dangerous, but it's also cruel, a claim disputed by the team.
Well, man's been working with elephants for something like 2,000 years.
and the others themselves have activity. In fact, are far better looked after than they are out in the wild with man and other animal poachers. And they love the game.
The cruelty occurs when the animals are kept in their beast wagons after the show, or when this is all finished. It's nice to see the animals wandering around here, but they're only doing this for a short period of time. Eventually, they'll go back into their beast wagons, and that's where they'll stay until they're falling in.
The circus maintains their animals are lucky enough to have their own play cages, and events like today's are enjoyed as much by the elephants as the spectators. Judy Laybourne in Berkshire for Thames News.
Okay, good. Yeah, we just now move on. Good. Okay, and that was
interesting because, again, we had to get lots and lots of elephants in.
So we contacted various circuses in across Europe, and they came, we had enough. And one large pantechnicon turned up with a whole lot of elephants in, with lots of trumpeting, when we arrived at the public car. And it turned out that the French had said there's African elephants, not Indian elephants, and they don't get on. They proceeded to kick the hell out of their lorry, and they had to take them a long way away because they can communicate easily with this vibration through their feet up to about 5 miles away. So trust the French to send along the elephants. And it's fascinating. You know, I always like, this is a bit about the difference on elephants. It's very easy, you can tell straight away. African elephants have got ears shaped like Africa. The Asian elephants have ears shaped like India. Very easy to tell. So we came back to England. We did the championships there. And Gloria Hunniford then had a TV program called 6 O'Clock Live that went out live. And I was asked with her to basically go on the show and take the elephant, Rani, which was the one, and just do a demonstration of the strokes and how we played and talk about as we're doing today, which was great fun. And it happened to be her birthday, which was very nice. And the manager of the studio said, Bruce, do you think the elephant would give Gloria a bunch of flowers? And I said, this is Rani, my elephant that I knew quite well. And I said, I'm sure. So that was wonderful. So I gave a bunch of flowers to the elephant, walked to Gloria's desk. The flowers were put on her desk. Then everybody clapped. What was that a signal for? The elephant picked up the flowers and ate them immediately, live on 6 O'Clock News, which is quite funny, wasn't it? It made me laugh quite a little bit. Okay, now we're going slightly sideways here, and you're wondering about this. Now, I'd like to just round up on what we've said as well, I think. And to do that, I like to think about it. I like to relax. So this is like an 8-hour process. It won't take us that long to round up, we hope. So if we can get that going. Yeah, it's necessary about that. Okay. So going back, as a side issue, when I was in Singapore working for the...
Sorry, I'm not sure if you will be able to do that myself far away.
It's only just there, is it?
I don't know in this room.
Okay. I've done it in lots of rooms before. It's never been a problem. It's up to you. It's going to be quick, very quick. I'll talk for now. Yeah, we'll go ahead. Very quick. So anyway, working for the Straits Times, initially I was doing births, deaths and marriages. That changed when somebody was sick and I moved on to doing film reviews and theatre reviews. So because of that, and I still do now, a weekly radio show for the BBC and write film reviews for the BBC. So about 2 years ago, they asked me, BBC, to go to Paris, Woody Allen was here, and to go and interview him, which was a magic thing to do. I really, really enjoyed it. And so I got to the restaurant, he turned up with Scarlett Johansson, which was magic. He ordered French soup, I just ordered a cold shower, but this is magic. So we did the interview, and what he said to me at the end of the interview, which was very important, he said to me, Bruce, if you're doing a presentation, what you should always do is something very flashy so people don't get up to you. I hope that was flashy enough. See, we haven't put it all down. Thank you. Any questions? Well, this week, and it's a bit of a side issue being a chemist, but it's still the same. Still the same. Good. I think that's it on there, isn't it? I think it comes to the end. Yeah, I'm sure it is. Okay. Oh, yeah, good. So that was a surprise. Well,
it's not a question, more a comment. I think comment. You remember the infamous Blue Peter episode.
When yes, it's exactly the same. Instead of pooing on the set, they ate the flowers. A friend of mine interviewed Gloria Hunniford recently. She's written a new book and that. And she said it's the funniest thing ever happened on her show. 6 o'clock live, you know, it's out live. We couldn't stop it. It happened. And it was very funny. It really was. Very funny. Good. So it's made a few people laugh, I hope.
How do you move the elephants around? I mean, you talk about moving them across countries. I mean.
Oh, yes. Well, basically lorries with articulated trailers, you know, the elephants were standing there quite well. Yeah,
quite yeah. Happy,
just as they do with in circus, moving them around, you know, or if they relocate them. For what happened with the circuses, a lot of the elephants then were rehabited in maybe wildlife life parks. And Ronnie, my elephant is in Poland now, then to a national, like a small game reserve there too. But they traveled very easily, surprisingly. I guess if you're part of a traveling circus, they're up and moving sticks all the time, so they probably get used to it, and they're born into the whole situation anyway. Yeah. But it's fantastic. There's something magical about elephants as well. It really is. Yeah.
Two really quick questions.
Yeah, don't worry.
First of which is, why didn't anyone tell me there was an option to undo the damage of when I tried to bleach my hair?
Colour before you weren't reading enough fashion magazines. And we had a CD commercial as well.
The damage from Poundland dyes.
Oh yeah. But it worked very well. Take you back to the cutting word before, and it was redox reaction. Yeah, and it was the reaction and the same chemistry that was used in the leather trade for removing cut hair or head or dyes from leather finishes. Yeah. So basically they were using. Chlorine dioxide as well in some of the old bleaching vats. It's old chemistry. There's not much brand new chemistry, but it's remarketed, repackaging for a different marketplace as well. I think that's being aware. It's all out there. It's modifying and changing the packaging. Again, on the chlorine dioxide, we developed a twin pack foaming system that produced a foam, and the bubbles contained chlorine dioxide, so there's no aroma, but on the surface, they broke and made it very, very effective surface disinfectant. They're marketed by a company called TriStar now and sold all over the world. I mean, the company's grown and grown. I did a license with them.
And that kind of actually leads into the second slightly more serious question I have, which was you made this point of as an industrial facing chemist, you always.
No, it, yeah, yes, it, yeah. Oh, sorry.
You focused on find a problem and then build a solution around it.
No, I think look for a problem. I mean, we're doing lots of work with companies, laser company treatments, so doing tattoo removals at the moment. And we've done a lot of work with ultrasound for breaking up the inks underneath and getting it back in. They go into the bloodstream with the removers anyway. So that's quite fascinating to be there because so many people now have become very middle class, and about 50% of the population over 30 has got a tattoo. And by the time they're 40, a lot of people hate them. Mm-hmm. So the ability to remove them is a good idea. So we work with Linton Lasers, who are a big laser group in UK, on working on doing those. So you look for problems and you look for marketplaces, changes. And I read a lot and I'm out about and being noisy. And I like trying to find problems.
I'm a fundamentals.
Yeah.
Old school academic.
Okay, good.
And I end up finding plenty of solutions without a problem, unfortunately. I was wondering, do you have any advice of how to sort of, you know, build those links and to, you know...
We looked at the problem of head lice and the problem of organophosphorus compounds, treatments going into children's scalps and all those sort of issues. And again, the same thing, it was in a Sunday Times cover supplement, and I looked at that, so this the problem, there's got to be something here. And the very next day, the Entomology Centre in Cambridge, there's a full article about that they had head lice there and were doing research and development. And I was thinking about there had to be a better way. And I went over to see the professor there and talked about head lice. And I said, look, how long can head lice hold their breath? He said, I don't know. Put them in the bell jar. It was about 7 hours before they died. So I looked at how to put the coating on the back of them because they breathe to the sprout, you know. And very simply, a reasonably viscous silicon oil suffocated them. They were never going to get used to the material. And we developed and licensed that. We marketed it initially under Chinese Whispers as the brand. It changed. And I was laying in the bath thinking, how can we get publicity? And so at that time, the Spice Girls were very popular. I invented the Lice Girls. I went to the local girls' school. We got itchy, scratchy, and they came to my drawing room. I phoned four newspapers, you know, Daily Mail, Daily. They all came up within 2 days. We're on national television with a girl singing, I'll tell you what we want, what we really, really don't want. And it's headless. We sold the license, done. You know? That is it, maybe called his lateral thinking, but it, you know, it works. So there was a problem, solved it. And then, because if you do solve a problem, you've got to then think how you're going to market it, how you're going to get your customers. And the best way is publicity, have a good PR company that you're working with. Or look at who's strong in the marketplace and talk to them. Look, I'm researching this, are you interested? Most of them will say yes, they're always interested in something new. Make sure you've written your patent well, and then go and see them. Yeah, never be frightened of putting lots and lots of patents in all around everything. Costs you nothing. The patent starts to get expensive after several years. Initially, it doesn't.
Costs you time.
It costs you time. There's no doubt it costs you time. You end up working 24 hours a day. I like work. I'm 80 years old. I still work till 10 o'clock at night.
I like work.
Yeah.
I don't like writing patents.
Okay, then go to a patent agent, get them to do it.
Then invest your money.
Yeah, but you have to look at things, yeah. You know, where you invest. In, I know. I don't drink, that's it. I'm saving the money to put it into patents.
That's nice.
But it's quite fun. And since then, we've formed a children's charity, and it's called the Bruce Green Foundation. And it's working, it's taking children with learning difficulties, or special needs children, to the cinema. So I have an arrangement with Cinema World. We take over their cinema at Christmas, 500 seats. We bus children from local schools in. They get popcorn. We've been doing this for now nearly 20 years. I've taken over 25,000 children to the cinema. That's an awful lot of popcorn. But it's a magic thing to be able to do. And that followed on from doing with BBC, doing reviews, and then having a critics pass with CineWorld. And they love what we're doing. So, you know, this things can happen for... They sort of, you sort of have to grab things, have a very open mind about all the things you do. Sometimes look at the Bruce Green Foundation, they'll show you what we're doing. We've got an open air theatre, we do a huge film show every year for about 5,000 people. I have a lot of fun. I really enjoy what I do. So, does that answer your question? No, not really. Yeah. But it's nice to be busy, and it's lovely to find niches for the things that you're passionate about too. Good. Well, thank you. Thank you for listening. Good. Good. Thank you.
So thank you everyone for joining us this evening, and thank you for Bruce Green to give us a fantastic talk about everything, and including elephants and other things. These were pretty interesting.
But also being nice.
One other thing, I would like to say a big thank you to the SCI who is sponsoring this talk tonight, and who's been in sponsorship and partnership with CPS for many years now. So the SCI stands for the Society for Chemistry Industry, and it's a brilliant and welcoming society for chemists with an interest in this field. So they offer frequent talks at their headquarters, which is just a few minutes walk from here. And they always hold other events, including the networking opportunities, career events, and the conferences and more. So if you would like to learn more about this, please don't hesitate to speak to us or one of the SC members in our room. And the price for each student is £25 per year. And thank you very much for listening today.
Thank you for being here.